We're so delighted to be here in Maine and home to your outstanding grantee, our outstanding grantee, Pine Tree Legal Assistance, and of course, Nan is I say she's a national treasure. We'll be hearing about the important work of Pine Tree this afternoon. We'll also be hearing remarks from Derek Langhauser, the chief counsel, general counsel to the governor, and Hancock Lumber CEO Kevin Hancock, who's the 2016 recipient of the Muskie Access to Justice Award, such a strong voice for expanding justice access in Maine. Our program features two panels. The first brings together leaders from government, social services, and legal aid to discuss how Maine meets the needs of survivors of domestic violence and sexual assault. It will be moderated by LSC's vice chair and Harvard's 300th university professor, Martha Minow. Maine's attorney general, as well as a former chief justice, will join legal aid experts on the second panel, focusing on ways to ensure access to justice in rural Maine. LSC's outstanding, and I mean outstanding, and longest serving president, Jim Sandman, will moderate that panel. Well, we gather here today as LSC is in the process of rolling out two important, far-reaching reports, one on a crippling national problem that has hit Maine particularly hard, the opioid epidemic. Maine's rate of nearly 30 opioid deaths per 100,000 residents is unfortunately double the national rate and was the sixth worst of 35 states reporting data to NIH in 2017. Well, our opioid task force, comprised of more than 30 leaders from legal and medical communities, federal and state government, veteran social services organizations, has made significant recommendations on how LSC and civil legal aid can work with other stakeholders in the medical, judicial, law enforcement communities to deal more effectively with this challenge. Among its many findings, and incidentally, this is the report. There are copies out there. They're online. I expect everybody to read it. The report recognizes that civil legal aid providers are in a unique position to address the legal issues facing low-income people with opioid use disorder, especially when these providers partner with healthcare providers and other entities, such as youth organizations, social service organizations, faith-based organizations, schools, law enforcement, state agencies, family justice centers, and local peer recovery groups. Only by rallying and coordinating efforts from the many sectors of our society will we be successful in overcoming this national tragedy. Well, we first released the report just last month in June in Washington. We've had events in Chicago and Nashville since then. Two of the co-chairs of that task force, both members of the LSC board, are here with us today. Former ABA president, and you heard him at lunch, Robert Gray, Vic Maddox of Louisville's Fultz, Maddox & Dickens. The third co-chair, David Hoffman, is a partner at my firm, Sidley Austin, a non-director member of LSC's audit committee, and we're fortunate that our firm actually supported the work of this task force. Well, the final event marking the release will be held next week in San Francisco at the ABA's annual meeting. We did not prepare this report to have it just gather dust and sit on a shelf. So we at LSC will create an ongoing working group to follow and encourage progress on the report's important recommendations. And also at the ABA meeting, we will preview the release of our second task force's report, and that's the Task Force on Disasters. This task force, composed of more than 60 leaders from the legal and medical communities. This task force has concluded its work and will release its findings on September 17th, you can mark that date, in Washington, with rollout events then in New York and the Midwest to follow. Two of the co-chairs of this task force are here with us today, Martha Minow and LSC board member Father Pius. The third co-chair is the former chief judge of the New York Court of Appeals, Jonathan Lippman, who's now of counsel to Latham & Watkins, and we're so grateful to that law firm for supporting the work of this task force. Then, on November 11th, the 100th anniversary of Veterans Day, LSC will continue another initiative by convening its second Veterans Day Summit in New York to highlight the importance of civil legal aid to this critical and underserved community. LSC and its grantees, none more important than Pine Tree Legal Assistance, assist veterans in a number of ways. By establishing medical legal partnerships with veterans health centers, operating hotlines, taking part in special stand downs, and providing on-site legal help at veterans centers. LSC also regularly briefs Congress on these and related problems faced by veterans and how important it is that they have access to legal assistance. And LSC has supported since its launch in 2010 of Pine Tree's remarkable statesidelegal.org, the first national website focused on helping veterans and military families. It has become an invaluable resource to this community. Last year, this very site had more than 400,000 visitors, nearly 900,000 page views. But as we gather here today, we still have a long way to go to ensure access to justice for all. Unfortunately, nearly 59 million Americans qualify for LSC-funded civil legal assistance because they currently live at 125% of the federal poverty guideline or below. LSC's most recent study of the justice gap in 2017 found that an estimated 1 million civil legal problems brought to LSC grantees by low-income Americans in 2017 did not receive the legal assistance required to fully address their needs because of lack of resources. Well, earlier this year, LSC conducted a new intake census of its 132 grantees, and that suggests that the level of unmet need detected in 2017 continues. The 2019 intake census focused on financially eligible clients who sought legal assistance for civil legal problems at LSC grantees during a four-week period. It found that 42% of the legal problems presented received no response service of any kind, actually an increase of 1 percentage point from 2017. It also found that only 27% of the eligible problems presented were fully served. As our LSC board has visited now over half of the states during its tenure, we have heard repeatedly from chief justices, judges, state officials, grantees, and state after state that low-income individuals in matters of enormous consequence for them and their families, from housing to domestic violence, are unfortunately on their own, without representation. The National Center for State Courts, in fact, reports that in almost 75% of civil cases in state courts, one or both parties are unrepresented. Studies also show that the represented parties have substantially higher success rates than those who are unrepresented. For example, in Virginia, win rates for represented defendants are 10 times those of unrepresented defendants in debt collection cases. 10 times. Based on national statistics, in fact, there's only one legal aid lawyer for every approximately 10,000 client-eligible individuals to serve their legal needs. So is it any wonder that our grantees are forced to turn away so many people? Although Congress actually increased LSC's funding for fiscal year 2019 to $415 million, that figure is significantly below what's needed, even below the $420 million actually appropriated in 2010, less than half of what in today's dollars, is the number I like to quote, that would be $880 million in inflation-adjusted dollars. That's the amount of the appropriation just 2 years after LSC's founding, in the 1970s. And at that time, only 12% of a smaller population qualified for LSC-funded assistance. Actually, even if Congress met LSC's fiscal year 2020 budget request for $593 million, and we still have hope, it would still be less in inflation-adjusted dollars than it was during many of the years of the Reagan administration. And this chronic underfunding of civil legal aid is much more than just another Washington budget battle over discretionary spending. There should be nothing discretionary about equal justice. I go around the country and say this. I don't believe equal justice is charity. I'm sure you don't either. Rather, as Justice Lewis Powell observed, it is one of the guiding principles of our democracy. That call for justice is in the preamble of our Constitution, on the facade of the Supreme Court, recited every day by our school children. Well, the country's first Chief Justice, John Marshall, recognized that liberty depends on access to justice. In Marbury versus Madison, you lawyers remember that case, he wrote, quote, "The very essence of civil liberty certainly consists in the right of every individual to claim the protection of the laws whenever he receives an injury. One of the first duties of government is to afford that protection," unquote. Ensuring access to justice is not simply a concern for judges and lawyers. It is a foundational civic duty for everyone, necessary to ensuring our democracy and the rule of law. This LSC board is committed to meeting this challenge, and we invite our fellow citizens across this country, both within and without the legal profession, to join in this effort. Thank you very much. It's now my great privilege to introduce Kevin Hancock, the Chief Executive Officer of Hancock Lumber. As I said earlier, he's the recipient of the 2016 Ed Muskie Access to Justice Award and has been such a strong supporter of civil legal aid. This spring, he submitted written testimony in support of a bill to increase funding for civil legal services here in Maine, and Governor Mills, she signed the bill into law in June of 2019. In 2017, he authored an article in the Portland Press Herald in support of continued funding for LSC, highlighting the success of LSC's grantee here in the state, Pine Tree Legal Assistance. He also recently served on Pine Tree cabinet, which raised $1.5 million for Pine Tree's endowment. His business, Hancock Lumber, is a four-time recipient of Best Places to Work here in Maine. The company is also a past recipient of the Maine Family Business of the Year Award, the Governor's Award for Business Excellence, the Maine International Trade Center's Exporter of the Year Award, and the Pro Sales National Dealer of the Year Award, a graduate of Bowdoin College. Please join me in welcoming Kevin Hancock.
Hello, everyone. Welcome, and particularly a warm welcome to the Board of the Legal Services Corp. Welcome to the state of Maine. We're very happy that you're here, and in a small way, I'm living proof that you're here in Maine, because when you think about it, where else but Maine would your speaker be the guy from the local lumberyard? I mean, seriously, like, I'm really lucky to be living where I'm living, but the work I do and the work you do could look very different, but the theme or the thought I wanted to share today was on how it's similar. And the way in which I think it's similar is that everyone in this room has a shared belief, I'm willing to bet, that every voice should matter. Not most voices, not on most days, but every voice, everywhere, every day should matter. And I really think that while the work you do is legal in essence, it's really the work of humanity that you're doing. I believe that the single most important idea in the history of humans, it's kind of a big one. I believe the single most important idea in the history of humans is equal before the law. I've thought about this a lot, and I've not yet come to a human idea that I think is more important than that one. Equal before the law on an individual level, every individual. Equal before the law. And that objective only has one alternative, and it's just clearly not desirable, which is unequal before the law. And when a community or a society or a planet becomes unequal before the law, everything tips the wrong way. And certain groups become favored, the law becomes arbitrary, and corruption prevails. And I think this story plays out time and time again across human history, whether it was East Germany and West Germany. To me, equal before the law was the only difference between the fate of those two countries. North Korea and South Korea, equal before the law. Those four words, in my view, are the difference between those two countries. And I'm a big optimist on this subject. I'm certain that the long arc of humanity is bending towards everyone has a voice. That's where humanity is headed. But it is a long arc that requires work for the long haul. Furthermore, I believe that the human quest could be described simply as the quest to self-actualize, for every individual to come into his or her never to be repeated again unique voice, to find it, to know it, to own it, and to bring it forth and share it with the world. And I'd like to tell you a quick story about how a lumber company executive from Maine came to these personal conclusions. And I'll start at the end and then back up. So it was the day before Halloween, October 2012, and I found myself a guy from a small town here in Maine, standing alone at the Wounded Knee Massacre site on the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation in the southwest corner of South Dakota. And a short while later, this really well-worn car pulled up. At Pine Ridge, they call it a res car because you can't get a permit to drive it in the state of South Dakota. And this lovely old jewelry maker, rolled down her window, rolled it down, and with a grand smile said, "What brings you here?" And I reciprocated her smile and said, "That's a great question." It was such a great question that it would take me four more trips to that remote reservation before I felt I began to know the answer. All I knew at the time was that I was searching, which is something I've since come to believe is universally human. I was searching for my voice, ironically, in a community where no one felt heard. I have a friend, Jose Miguel Sokoloff, who's Colombian, who has a saying I love, which is this: we all adhere to a belief system, otherwise we don't have a strategy for dealing with a complex world. Four dates contribute to my belief system: 1848, 2007, 2010, and 2012. 1848, that's the year our company began doing business here in Maine. And I'm part of the sixth generation of my family to work for our company. And we have 550 people today who are a part of our team across Maine. We grow trees, we manufacture lumber, and we distribute lumber and building materials globally and locally. In 2007, as you know, the national housing and mortgage markets began to collapse. In the 3 years that followed, our sales fell by 50%, essentially without losing a customer. That's just how much smaller the construction market got in a hurry. In 2010, at the peak of that collapse, unconnected to me then, but totally connected to me in hindsight, I began to have trouble speaking. So when I would go to talk, all the muscles in my throat would spasm and squeeze and contract, and my voice got very, very broken and hoarse and hard, even often for someone sitting right beside me to hear. So I went to a doctor and then another doctor and another doctor, and about a year later, I ended up at the Mass Eye and Ear Clinic in Boston, where my now friend, Dr. Song, told me I had spasmodic dysphonia, which is a rare neurological disorder that affects only speech with no known cause and no known cure. At the time of onset, however, I didn't know what I had. I had no strategy for dealing with it, and I could barely talk. And I laugh about this now, but I said to myself at the time, what possible good could a CEO be who can't talk all the time? And how am I going to go about doing my job? And initially, my strategy was just to protect my voice. So when it's hard to talk, you find ways to talk less. And the simple way I found to talk less was to ask more questions, and particularly to answer a question with a question. So picture this age-old scene at work. Someone comes to me with a question because I'm the boss or one of the leaders of the company, and I would listen to the question but knew I wasn't going to be able to give an answer. So I started saying, That's a great question. What do you think we should do about it? And originally, I started saying this just to put the conversation back on the other person. Then that person would tell me what he or she thought we should do about it. And if it was at all reasonable, which it essentially always was, I said, that sounds great, let's do that. I'm not kidding you. This was like my management approach. And off he or she would go with his or her solution to his or her problem. And over time, you know what struck me. People already knew what to do. They already had great answers to the difficult problems that they saw. And so it really fascinated me, if they already knew what to do, why weren't they doing it? And how gentle or simple a push it took for people to trust their own judgment and run with it. So on to Pine Ridge, and then I'll come back and wrap this up. So by 2012, the economy had settled, and I could see that our company, my tribe, community was going to be fine, and I had this growing sensation at the time that I tried to fight, but I couldn't, which was I needed to serve myself a little bit more, to catch my breath or to find my voice. And I didn't know how I was going to go about doing that, but that summer in August, I was at the Portland Jetport, and I picked up a copy of National Geographic, and the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation was on the cover. There was a young Lakota boy riding a Mustang bareback across a rolling hill, and the title read, in the spirit of Crazy Horse, the rebirth of a Sioux Nation. And I read that article, and it was as if every character ever connected to that story jumped out of that yellow magazine and gave me a hug. And when I finished, I leaned over and I patted my wife on the leg and I said, I'm going to go there. That was my entire plan. I'm going to go there. I want to see what life is like for the people who have been there. I've since been there 20 times. Have tons of friends there. Was really embarrassed about how to answer initially what I did there, because I didn't do anything there. I just hung out with the people who lived there. I didn't go there to fix, save, change, or correct anyone. I was just really, really interested in the people who lived there, and I felt they had lots to offer the world that wasn't being seen or heard, if you will, and taken advantage of. And I've since come to believe that awareness and connectivity in and of itself is a really powerful act. But the combination of my own voice condition and then traveling to Pine Ridge really helped me see two things, which is, I think, the connector back to the work you do. There are lots of ways to lose your voice in this world. And the second thought, which really made me kind of freeze in my tracks, is that probably throughout history, leaders had done more to restrict and inhibit and limit the voices of others than to release them. The Sioux have 7 sacred rites, and one of them you definitely would have heard of. It's the Vision Quest rite. And the Vision Quest, in my view over time, listening and learning, was really about helping individuals come into their own voice. You had to leave your tribe, journey alone into the wilderness, and pray or cry for a vision. The Lakota term is hamblechi'a, which means to cry for a vision. And if you were fortunate enough to receive some insight into the essence of who you were expected to come back and stand in circle and share what you learned about your own voice and your own truth and live your life in accordance with that message and mission. And that's when it occurred to me at one point out west that I was having a bit of my own modern day vision quest experience. And the vision was simply this: the partial loss of my own voice, which they told me was incurable, and I've largely cured, not completely, but largely, and I love that fact, but the partial loss of my own voice, which I'd only previously thought of as a hindrance or a disability or a pain in the neck, was actually a blessing, and it was a gift, and it was a calling, and it was an opportunity, because I was in a position of leadership, and the opportunity was to do what I could to help strengthen the voices of others, especially those who did not always feel heard, whether they were on a remote reservation on the Northern Plains, or in a sawmill, or a lumberyard in Western Maine. So back at work, just to wrap up, the idea became super simple. What if we could create a culture where everybody led, where every voice felt trusted, respected, valued, and heard? Wouldn't an organization where everybody led outperform a more traditional model where just a few people held all the decision-making cards? But more importantly, beyond economics, wouldn't it be more socially valuable? Adults need places to self-actualize, to keep coming into their own voice across the journey of a lifetime. And because so many people work, and because everybody at work is super important, work is actually a great platform to pursue that mission. And I could go on and on about this, but you have lots of super cool things to do today. But that's the story, perhaps the unexpected story, of how a lumber company executive and yourself might have actually found themselves on a common mission of strengthening the voices of others, making sure that every individual is heard, and recognizing that if that cannot happen before the law, that it's at risk everywhere. So I really salute you and the work you do, and appreciate the opportunity to be a small part of your time together here in Maine. So I'll close with this. As they say at Pine Ridge, Wopila Tonka, which means big thanks. Thank you for having me.